The 20th century French composer Claude Debussy said that for him, the miracle of Bach was that no matter how complex the music becomes, and you cannot imagine anything more complex than that, that no matter how complex it is, the idea is never lost.
Right.
The thrust of it is never lost. Right. So that really, truly, within the greatest complexity, the greatest simplicity is revealed.
Right.
And that's one amazing composer. So again, that was the fugue in B minor, ending on a B major chord, which in Bach's tuning system would have been at the edge of intelligibility, right, really kind of right in your face or a directive, as opposed to the C major where we started, which was, as the poet Goethe said, the stillness of the breast of God before he created the world. That's what it was for him. So anyway, that's the well-tempered clavier. We'll move on to Domenico Scarlatti. If you're looking at your programs, you notice that Bach, Handel, and Scarlatti were all born in the same year, 1685. It was a very good vintage, you know. I know, it's hard to believe they all came in on the same common. But anyway, they did, and of course they lived very different lives. Bach is from hardworking, kind of middle-class Lutheran musician family, whereas Scarlatti is from in Rome. His father is a great opera composer, a very famous opera composer. So young Domenico Scarlatti would probably have enjoyed hearing the best singers in Europe rehearsing at home with his father on a daily basis. It'd be like being the son of Steven Spielberg or something. It was like you had every advantage possible. Domenico Scarlatti grows up to be a magnificent keyboard player with chops like nobody had ever seen, really. And he actually was in a playoff with Handel when they were both about 20 years old. They both were at the same court one night in Rome, and apparently Scarlatti won on the harpsichord and Handel won on the organ. Scarlatti gets a great job working way far away from Italy in Portugal when he's in his late 20s. He becomes the private music teacher to the princess in Portugal and also the harpsichordist for the court band. He and the princess get along so well that when she grows up and marries and becomes the Queen of Spain, she takes Scarlatti with her. That's like a personal trainer, you know. And so he's with her the rest of his life. Scarlatti only publishes a few of his sonatas during his lifetime. There's about 100 or so that are published and enjoy some popularity in England and a few other places. But there are over 500 sonatas, most of which existed in manuscript and other things, and which were preserved by Scarlatti's friends, chiefly among them was Farinelli, the great singer at the last of the castrato, that is male sopranos, from back in those days. So anyway, so we have Scarlatti's incredible output, thanks mostly to a few friends. Scarlatti, somewhere in his life, discovered that he was the master of the 2-to-4-page sonata. These are all in binary form. It was like he was the short story genius of his time. The Hemingway of the harpsichord, or something like that. And unlike Bach, I mean, he's not a particularly religious composer. He's very spiritual, but he's more of it in a secular vein. And there's lots of guitar writing in this and street music from the Spanish streets and with Scarlatti's own brand of virtuosity. The other thing I want to say about Scarlatti is that he probably composed everything at the harpsichord. His music is designed to make this particular type of instrument light up the way that Chopin wrote at the piano. So that Chopin's music is for the piano, and this is for the harpsichord. Two sonatas by Scarlatti.